welcome friends to this special meeting we are having today. I will be speaking in English. How many of you understand English? How many don't understand English? It appears everybody understands English. So we will not need any translator for my talk today. I have come to share with you certain experiences that we don't normally have in our daily life. Most of the time, we live in a world which attracts us, keeps us busy, creates responsibilities and obligations. So we have to study in school, we have to get jobs, we have to work on our jobs, take care of families, take care of children, and eventually, being so busy, we end our life and die. It appears that our whole life, from the birth to the death, is spent looking at things outside of our own self. We have never cared to see, is there another world, something quite interesting happening inside us? When I say inside, I mean inside this body of ours. Our sense perceptions all operate to take us outside. We have eyes to look outside, ears to hear outside, legs and feet to do and walk outside. Everything we have, nose to smell outside. All the time we are using this physical body to go outside. But there is something which is not physical, like our thinking process. We don't think from outside, we think inside. We think in our head. But even the thinking process we are using for outside, we are all the time thinking about things that are outside of us. How come we never have an idea of thinking about what is happening inside us? What is happening in the very area where we are thinking? We almost feel that we are locked out from our own self, that our self operating as a conscious living being is locked up inside and we are prisoner of outside. How can we get free from this prison of outside all the time? I have come to share with you that this can be done very easily by most people. Only you have to be told how to do it. If you notice, there are some things we do which are not physical. For example, imagining things. We can imagine anything. We can imagine right here a small house built of silver and gold. We don't see it outside, but we can imagine it right here. We can imagine so many things which do not exist outside. Therefore, we have a faculty available to us called imagination. It's a very important faculty. But we waste that faculty also in imagining things outside. When we want to think of something, we also imagine things and we connect them. Our whole attention remains outside. Now, attention is a very important part of our process of thinking. When we think, we put attention on something. We can put attention on an idea, put attention on a subject matter that's outside. We don't put attention on the one who is putting the attention outside. We do not care to see that there is a self, our true self, not the body, a true self that exists inside us, which is operating and doing things like thinking, imagining, putting attention on things, focusing attention, concentrating attention. These are many useful things we do with human attention. But have we ever thought what would happen If instead of putting attention on these things outside, we put attention inside on our own self. It's very simple, but we don't do it. Simple thing is, if we put attention on our own self, we will discover so much more. And I have come to share with you what we can discover if you just put your attention inside yourself. We are used to using attention by focusing attention on things. Every time we focus attention on anything, our attention goes out. Even when we are told, why don't you put your attention on yourself, we try to focus attention on ourselves. Now, you remember, when you focus attention, you are putting the object or the subject matter of attention away from yourself. You are the one putting attention, not the attention itself. Who are you? Where does it come from? When we attend to a book, read a book, and we are trying to understand what the book is, where are we understanding it from? Where is that self that can understand things, can think about things, can appreciate things? It is inside our head. Mostly we use our eyes to look out. Sometimes we have a feeling also that there is something outside. But most of the time, our awareness, our knowledge of this world and ourselves is based on looking out from the eyes. Can we look inside? That's a good question. Can we really look inside? These eyes are not designed to look inside. These eyeballs and the retina inside, the optic nerve that carries the message to the brain, all designed to look outside. Pictures from outside come and they create images on the retina, which is conveyed to the optic nerve. We say we can see. The whole pattern of the physical body is designed to look outside. Therefore, to use these eyes to look inside is impossible. They're not meant for that. But we can use eyes which are not these eyes to look inside. When we imagine things, which eyes are we using? We can right now close our eyes and say, I can imagine things. Where are you imagining from? Where are those eyes that can see things, actually see things in imagination? Things that don't even exist here. How can we imagine and see things? Are those eyes that are seeing? Is it your mind that is seeing? Where does it come from? Well, if we try to practice for a little while, sitting at the point from where we imagine things, which you notice will be behind these eyes, we can close our eyes, imagine better. If we close our eyes and imagine things inside, we will also know where we are imagining it from. You will notice that those eyes which imagine and see imaginary things lie inside. What else can we do? If we can see with imaginary eyes inside, we can also feel a body inside. We can stand up with our eyes closed inside in imagination. We can stand up. Where do we do it? Not with these legs. Not on this floor. But on a floor we create by imagination behind our eyes. This is a very important point, that all that we are doing through imagination is happening in a very small area behind the eyes. People sometimes refer to that area as a third eye center. Why do they call it third eye center? Why not call them inner eyes? There's a good reason for that. The reason is that these two eyes, physical eyes, do not see the same thing outside. They see two different pictures. You might have noticed that sometimes we go to a 3D movie, a third three-dimensional movie, and they give us special glasses to wear There are two pictures on the screen, and with those glasses, we combine them, and they look like there's a depth, and things become near and far. These two eyes are doing exactly the same thing. They see two pictures all the time. You can test it very easily. Just putting a finger in front of you and looking at a distance, you'll see two fingers. One looks stronger, one looks weak. If you look at the finger, it becomes one. You concentrate your attention on the finger, it becomes one. The rest of the thing becomes two. There is a combination of the two pictures, these eyes see. Then can you imagine, where do we combine? When we look at one image, where are we combining the two images? We are combining exactly behind the eyes, in the center, at the very place we call the third eye center. We are always operating from there. Every time we are awake and looking outside, we are operating from the center of our head. Some people want to be more specific. Where is that area actually? Physiologically, biologically, where are we actually operating from? If you watch very carefully, when you close eyes and feel, where am I operating from as a living conscious being? It is very close to what we call the pineal gland or a pituitary body, just on top of the oblongata. It's exactly the center. In layman's language, you could say that we are constantly seeing, imagining, and thinking things from a third eye center, which is exactly behind these eyes, between the ears, in the center of the head. If we understand that is where we operate from in our wakeful state, what would happen if we put attention on ourselves at that point? People have done it. We call it meditation. Why do we call it meditation? Because to meditate means to think about something. We are all meditating all the time. We meditate upon our affairs, our relationships, our studies. We meditate upon what we are going to do next. We are thinking about things all the time, and we are meditating on things outside. Now, if we start thinking about where are we, who are we, what's happening, are we really there, and try to check it out, then we are meditating on the self. When we meditate on the self, it becomes a spiritual exercise, an exercise to know your own self, to know your real conscious self, not merely the body which is a covering upon it, not even the sense perceptions of the body, which are also to be used for outside, but your true self that is operating inside the body. Now, I am going to share with you that if you are able to sustain your attention at the third eye center by doing nothing else but imagining you are there and seeing things around you right there, imagining things around you there, imagining you can stand and dance and sing over there, if you can perform all the activities we are performing with the body outside, but you perform them inside your head behind the eyes, you will notice you have a remarkable body inside which has all the sense perceptions that this body, physical body, has. In fact, much sharper sense perceptions that this physical body has. If you have difficulty in reading, your eyes are not very sharp, you're using glasses or something, inside the vision is better than 20/20, because the sense perception of seeing through your imagination inside is much sharper. The sense of smell is much sharper. The sense of touch is much sharper. All sense perceptions are much sharper. It's amazing we do not know that the sense perceptions which we are using to look at the world are so much sharper if you were to concentrate your attention on the inner sensory system that operates as a body inside you. Looks like imagination, but that's merely a way to discover what else is inside. Once you discover that, you will say, what is the difference between this physical body and the body you discover, which imagines, which thinks, which functions independently. The difference is only one. This body has matter, physical matter, atoms and molecules. That body does not have that. The rest is identical. It has the same sense perception, the same power of thinking, the same power of loving, the same power of attaching, same power of doing everything, except it does not have matter. And because it does not have physical matter, it has certain advantages. The biggest advantage is it is not affected by gravity. Therefore, you can fly. Can you fly in that body outside of yourself? Or is it only that you can fly in your imagination? If you can sustain an experience separate from this body, that means you are only experiencing the inner body, you can fly anywhere you like, even in this physical universe or any other universe. That's an amazing possibility. We don't try it. Nobody teaches us this. But actually it's a very simple exercise. A simple exercise to put your attention inside exactly where we are operating from in the wakeful state, and then see what all we can do. But in order to be independent from this body, at least in awareness, we have to find a way by which we can become unaware of this body and retain the awareness of the inner body. That is actually a technical point. How do we achieve inner awareness and lose outer awareness at the same time? This process of meditation requires only two things: your attention and the power to concentrate it. And both are gifts given to us. All of us have it. How do we use it? We put attention on ourselves. That means imagine of nothing else but what is happening inside. Close our eyes, it's easier. Sit in a place where there's less distraction, easier. All these great meditators try to choose a nice place to sit, quiet from, make it very quiet, dark if possible, so no light is affecting you. You can close your ears and eyes if you like, just to make it easy to think of nothing outside but inside. What happens? The concentration of attention is a very beautiful thing when it concentrates your attention on something and creates more awareness of that. Simultaneously, it makes you less aware of what is outside of it. If you go to an orchestra, all the musical instruments are playing, but you like the drums better. Put your attention on the drums. Carefully listen to the drums. You'll find drums will become louder, other instruments will become weaker. There has been no change there. Only your attention is picking up something more by concentrating itself on drums. Others are weak. This is a great process. This process of concentrating attention on one thing and becoming unaware of others. Supposing, here's some beautiful flowers next to me. I want to look at the flowers and appreciate them and put all my attention on the flowers. I'll become less aware of who else is here. If all my attention goes on flowers, I won't even know you are here. This is the very nature of the power of concentrating attention. When we concentrate our attention upon our inner self behind the eyes at the third eye center, we gradually lose the awareness of our body. This process has sometimes been called dying while living. It's interesting to call it that way, because when people die, physical death, when they leave this body, or the life ends on this body, it does not end all of a sudden, all over the body. Sometimes it will go very quickly, sometimes it is slow. I have seen several people dying many of my friends have died, and some in terminal illnesses, where you could see that death was creeping upon them. What happens? When you are dying, you don't die all at once. You first die in your feet and hands. A person dying says, place my feet there. The feet are already there. The awareness of the feet disappears. Awareness of the hand disappears. Extremities die first. Then the legs and arms are not known. When the bottom of the torso is not known, awareness is pulling out. A person feels, when I'm floating in the air. The body is still there. The awareness is going away. As it happens, the torso moves from bottom to the top. The person is still talking to us and feeling he or she is floating away in the air. And as it goes up, the person cannot speak, tries to speak, cannot speak. We can see the eyes moving, trying to say something, but cannot speak. It goes higher. The eyes become still. The brain is dead, person is gone. The process of physical death is exactly like that. Now, when you concentrate your attention behind the eyes, what happens? You, after some time, do not know where your hands and feet are. If you stay longer in concentration, you won't know where the legs and arms have gone. If you stay longer, you won't know where the bottom of the torso has gone. Exactly the same procedure. What happens in physical death happens when you process your attention by concentrating behind the eyes. It's remarkable that in this process, the heart is beating normally, breathing is going on normally, the vital signs are all okay, and yet you are experiencing the same withdrawal of attention, withdrawal of awareness from your body all towards the head where you are occupying your attention and concentrating it. By doing that, you are able to achieve a state where your inner self becomes sharp and you are no longer aware of the outer body. That's the time when your inner self is discovered to be, in a way, not as imaginary as you thought, nor as temporary as you thought, because suddenly you find that the mind inside that inner self is functioning the same way as the mind functions in this, except its memory has been enlarged. Here we can't even remember things. I can't remember last week what breakfast I had. I can't remember who I met. Memory is so short here. And certainly we can't remember if we were ever alive in any form before we were born. We have no idea. We restrict our awareness to this physical life and can't even remember most of it. When we are in there, we remember not only things that happened earlier on this physical body, in this life, we remember things happened to us hundreds of years back. Where is that coming from? It's not somebody else telling us or saying you're going to past life regression or something. How are you remembering things? Because the mind in that body is functioning slightly differently. That is because the life of that inner body is longer than the life of the physical body. Big discovery. That's the biggest discovery you will find through this process of meditation, that the inner body, which you think is just imaginary, has actually been there and is part of your life force, which is making this physical body alive. That is more real. The sense perceptions have been placed into this body because of the inner body. The mind has been placed into this body because of the inner self. It can be verified. We don't need to study books to do that. You need to study yourself. It's a personal validation, not coming from anybody else's experience. And you should not go by anybody else's experience if you really want to study your own self. You must validate it with your own experience. And this is a wonderful way to discover that what we thought was our only body, our only life, is not the only life. This human life, this human body has been created only for a short period. and inside it lies something that's longer lasting. It's a personal discovery. Not only memories go back. You fly and there's a constant DMO that you have seen this thing before. You remember things you saw, never saw in this body, but you can recall them. Sometimes we do that even in physical body. We go to a place, I think I have been here before. We meet a person, I think I have known this person for a long time, even longer than I can remember. Where do those feelings come from? It does not mean they're just feelings. It actually means the memory is being triggered to remember something. But this physical body has been trained, the mind in the physical body has been trained. This is the only life, there's the only self, the body is yourself. The brain is functioning and creating all experiences. We are so much embedded with this brainwashing that we cannot think beyond it. But an experience is different. All brainwashing disappears when you have your own experience that there is something existing inside you that was living before you were born. And it was not somebody else, it was your own self. The same self which says, I am so and so, the same self is inside. It's very amazing. So doing this exercise is called true meditation on the self, that you can discover that the self was not merely the physical body. There's more to it, and it can be discovered by a simple process. I call it simple because it is simple. I've just explained it's only putting attention on your own self inside. It's simple but difficult. Now, why should it be difficult if it is simple? It is difficult because we have trained our mind to think always outside. When we try to concentrate our attention inside, the mind fights and runs outside. Why does it run outside? Only two reasons. Desires, which have been created by external temptations, external things, and attachments to those desires. We have lived a life of desires for outside things and are attached to them. And these attachments come up like thoughts, come up like distractions to our power to concentrate our attention inside. That is why it becomes difficult in the sense it takes much longer than would be if we didn't have these distractions of desires and attachments outside. But if you are able to control yourself, and for that we use many methods to control the mind going away outside. We control it by many ways. The easiest way that people who have been using meditation have used is repetition of words called mantra, called holy words, called special words. You can call them anything. Those words are inducted into our mind and we have to repeat them mentally so the mind cannot think of other things. It's a mechanical thing. We use outside words and make them very sacrosanct so that we get more attention to it. And we repeat those words with the mind so that we don't give place to the mind. It's like a replacing the thoughts of the mind which are being pulled by our attachments and desires outside to replace them with artificial words. And the more we practice them, the less we can think of outside and one way of doing it. Another way, more subtle and a very beautiful way. I like that much more than repetition of words. And that is when we are sitting in a very quiet place, absolutely quiet place that we can find, we can still hear some sounds. Some sounds seem to be coming from outside, some sounds coming to be ourselves. I met a Japanese meditator, and he had a meditation center in Japan, in Kyoto, and he said, I want to find a place of complete stillness where there is no sound. So he made a soundproof sort of a cave of glass, a glass small dome in which even the air that was pushed in for breathing was controlled to be silent. So there should be no noise. And he said, I want you to come and look at it and go in. I went there. When I went there, first of all, I've never been hearing the beating of my heart. I could hear very clearly. I could hear my breathing clearly. There's so many sound gurgling in the belly, I could easily see. Not only that, I could hear the blood vessels creating sounds. There's so many physical sounds. How can you escape them? But the best thing is that apart from these physical sounds, inside or outside, there is a sound, a very subtle sound, coming from the self itself. That's beautiful. If you are able to place your attention behind the eyes and stay there for a while, you'll hear a sound that comes from within yourself, from the center, same place where you are behind the eyes, third eye center. Not from right or left side. Right and left side can be very biological sound, can be a sound from different parts of the body. But when it comes from where you are, it's like a surround sound. Like you are actually radiating that sound outside. Takes a little practice. Because if you are totally starting in the beginning, your attention is all out. It takes time to gather attention enough to sit behind the eyes. But when you can sit there, you can start hearing the sound. It may look like a whistling sound. It may look like, in the beginning, like a thunder, like birds chirping, like small bells ringing. Some people confuse with tinnitus. Maybe you're having some problem in the ear. Those sounds that come, there are sounds which can be looking like very near and very far. The more you concentrate your attention on your own self, sounds that come from far off and very melodious sounds, great melody in them, come closer to you. All that is happening is you are getting close to your own self. And the sound that really pulls you, as if it is making you concentrate your attention off its own self, is a sound that resembles a big bell. No, no. Like a big bell sound with a long peal. And as you listen to that, the listening pulls your attention inside. Nothing greater than listening to yourself. Not your words, not thoughts, listening to the sound of yourself that comes from the self. I have practiced many types of meditation in my life out of pure curiosity to see what else is possible. And out of all the methods of concentrating attention on the self, I found this to be the best. Put your attention on the sound of the self. Period. Works the best. Take the time to get there. Sometimes I wonder if the bells in the belfries of our churches were placed for that reason, to remind us. Were these bells placed to remind us of the inner bell? Are so many temples using bells for that reason? Are we playing music, singing in choirs, singing in most places of worship? Is it because it's a reminder that the real music is coming from inside? It does occur to me there's some relevance to that. Is it true that the old days we used to make domes and played bell sound there just because the head is like a dome and the true bells are ringing inside? Is there some relationship? Well, these are just questions, more academic questions. But the real thing is that when you hear that sound, it pulls you to yourself and makes you unaware of the body, physical body, faster than any amount of repetition of words. That's why I prefer it. This is sometimes called the spiritual way of attainment by putting attention on the sound. In Indian language, we sometimes call it the Surta Shabd Yoga. Surta means attention, Shabd means sound, Yoga means union with your true self. And I like this yoga the best out of all I have practiced. And I want to make it very clear and simple that there is no question of blind faith in anything, in any of these practices. In fact, I discourage any blind faith. It becomes difficult for me to discourage people from blind faith because they have been indoctrinated by their religions into accepting blind faith. So there's a resistance to saying, don't have blind faith. Normally, common sense would say, it's a good thing not to have blind faith, have a living faith that you're experiencing. Only go by your experience. But we sometimes hold on to some principles called faith, some belief systems called faith, and it becomes blind faith. Somebody had an experience, said something about it, and we believe it. That's blind. If we have our own experience, and it grows, like all things that grow, it's a living experience. We must have a living experience, and that comes by personal practice. Personal practice of going within. If some people have left some guidance on their own experiences, useful for us, it gives us some guidance. But mere guidance is not enough. To act upon that guidance and experience the same thing ourselves is what creates living faith. So that is why I always suggest that we should go by living faith by our own experience. Now, I have given you a very small example of discovering our sensory systems inside. Sometimes we call that inner body astral body. Why do we call it astral body? Astral refers to the sky. The sky of the inner self is different. You might notice you can be in a completely dark room, no light, eyes closed, even covered with blinders. And you are imagining seeing a light, you can see it. You want to imagine colors, you can see them. You want to see forms and friends, you can see them. How do you see inside? Which light makes our imagination see things which we can't see outside at all? If this hall was dark, we wouldn't see anything. With eyes closed, we can see everything. Because the sky inside does not have the night and day like the sky here has. There is a twilight zone light. That means an evening light, dawn light, something like that, continuously there. Moreover, we see things because things themselves show up. Even in darkness, sometimes we say they are radiant figures inside. The nature of the sky is different from the sky here. That is why the inner self has been called the astral self, and the inner world that we experience, which has many parts, is called the astral world. Why many parts? There is a part of that inner experience which is connected with the physical. We imagine things inside physical. We imagine things inside which are not physical. So there's a division even of the astral state of being. Half of it is overlapping with the physical, and half of it is not. The one that does not overlap contains things like heavens and hells, which we've read about, seen, but never seen it personally. Inside you can experience personally. We have other experiences inside, apart from flying, because there is no matter in that body. We have an experience of communication, a little different from the physical communication. To communicate with each other, we use language here. Language is merely putting into phonetic sounds something that you want to say, which is in your head. What you want to say is one thing. To put it into language is another thing. I asked right in the beginning, if you know English, if I spoke in Lithuanian, you may not understand me. If I spoke another language, you may not understand me. Why? There's a big limitation, huge handicap. Sitting in the physical body, we understand through language, spoken, written language. Inside, we understand without language. We understand what is intended to be conveyed by language. Something we call here telepathic communication. When some people say we can have telepathic communication, I know instantly they are using their astral self for that. Even here, not many people do it. Now, if you have telepathic communication and you think in Estonian, and I don't know Estonian language, I know English, I'll understand it in English. Not only inside, even here. You must have noticed that people who use telepathic communication here, they don't use language. They think in their head in language. They're trained to do that. And the other person gets the message that is being conveyed in the language the other person understands. There you don't even need to know the language. Communication is very different and very simple. Also, time is very different. Here, time flows in a certain way. Events come on our time frame here. We feel time is flowing. Time doesn't flow. Time is stationary. We flow on it. Our attention flows on it. And that is why events come. All events are placed on the time frame, and we go from event to event. We can't stop. Therefore, we think time flows. With that body, time can stop. That means you can stop on time at any place. Big difference. Now, these are such remarkable experiences that you compare what you can experience inside, and yet you are in the physical body. You're sitting here doing this. You haven't died to be disembodied to have that experience. You are having it right here, and you get back any time into physical body and relate to people what you've experienced. It's a remarkable ability we all have, without exception. Does not matter which country you come from, does not matter what culture you belong to, does not matter what religion you follow. It's open to everybody to discover who they are. But that is not the end of the story. This is just the beginning of the story. To reveal your full self, this is just a beginning. Discovering one body, another body, is just a body, not yourself. What makes this body alive? What makes the inner body alive? That is the self. That's a question still remains. It can still be found out by meditating on the inner body. Identical way. Inner body has the same shape, same sense perceptions, same form as this one, and therefore we can meditate at the third eye center of the inner body. When you do that, what happens? Sense perception as we know it here is divided. Seeing is different from hearing. Of course, recently the scientists have been able to store light as sound. And there are some cases, about 300 cases, where people can hear with the eyes and see with the ears. Few exceptional cases where there's wrong nerves being attached to the brain. But there, when you meditate and leave your even the sensory system behind, you open up another self where perception is direct and not spread out into different forms. Perception is by the mind. In fact, that body is called the mind. Sometimes we call it the causal body. It causes all experiences to happen. The thinking mind, which we think is just a brain functioning, through this process you can discover it's part of a covering upon ourself, and we're using it to think. Thinking is just a machine operating in us. Just because you can think does not mean you are the thinker. You are using an apparatus installed in you, given to you, to use for thinking. The most remarkable thing about thinking is that thinking takes place only in time and space. And our life is not confined to time and space. We do things even now which defy time and space. For example, we get an intuitive feeling, a gut feeling, suddenly know something. We don't know from where. No thought. We know, I know it. How do you know it? I don't know how, but I know it. What does the mind say? Mind says, no, must be just a bad gut feeling or something. Here we are doing something right now which is beyond time and space. And that's not the only thing. The other things we are doing which are not in time and space. The experience of falling in love. Not in time and space. You don't think yourself into love. Mind cannot create love. Something else does. Now there is a self inside you which is even beyond the mind, where intuition is working, love is working, appreciation of beauty is working, and they come instantly in our life right here and also inside. Therefore, the mind which thinks is not ourself. It is just a device given to us, an organic device attached to our own self. That is why sometimes we have a different word for our own self. We don't say the mind is the self, we say our soul, our spirit. The mind functions as a covering upon the soul. Senses cover it again, physical body again. We have three coverings upon ourselves. And imagine that with the very simple practice of withdrawing attention to the self, we can be unaware of all the three coverings and become the soul and discover where consciousness per se is coming from, where life itself is coming from. It's a remarkable gift that we have been given, this possibility of having this experience. You discover so many things. You discover the nature of creation. You discover the nature of yourself. You discover why you are here. You understand the whole purpose. You discover at the mental level, at the causal level, how destinies are created, why we are born in a particular place, how events are created. Answers to all our questions are all inside us. We don't need to go anywhere outside to get answers to our deepest questions. What the purpose of life? What life is? What soul is? What immortality is? Immortality comes where there is no time. Soul subsists in no time and no space. Time and space are created by the mind. Above the causal level where the soul exists, there is no time and space. So that is why it's immortality. It's a wonderful experience, cannot be fully described because all our descriptions are based upon thinking in space and time. That is why we can't describe, but you can experience it. An individual can experience. I am sharing these experiences with you, not ideas. We can have any idea we like, but experience is different from an idea. And these experiences are within our reach. If we are interested, some people come to me and say, I'm not interested in any of this stuff. I'm enjoying my life. I said, go ahead, enjoy. Who's stopping you? If you are feeling very happy in this life, go ahead. But after a week or so, he comes back to me. You know, I am suffering so much. I am very unhappy. I said, last week you were happy. What happened now? He says, physically I was all right. I have a nice house, I've got money, I've got this thing. But emotionally I'm destroyed. The person I loved just dumped me suddenly. How do you think I can be happy? Does my house give happiness? Does money give happiness? When you're suffering so badly emotionally, when you're so badly hurt. When I look at people around, I find nobody is really happy. There's some happiness and some unhappiness. Sometimes the unhappiness looks bigger than the happiness. Maybe they're equal. Let me imagine that our state of happiness and state of suffering are equal in life. It goes like a sine curve, sometimes happy, sometimes like this sine curve, up and down, up and down. How would we feel overall? We'll feel it's an unhappy life. There's a reason for that. When we are happy, time passes very quickly. When we are unhappy, it slows down. Oscar Wilde, that English author, has said, suffering is one long moment. If one moment can become long, you are in pain and suffering. If you are happy, enjoying yourself, time flies quickly. That is why even if the time of our life were divided equally between suffering and happiness, it would look like it's an unhappy life. The sharing of my experiences is for those who are unhappy, not for those who are happy. For those who are happy, my message is enjoy yourself. For those who feel there is unhappiness of any kind, I suggest you find out the truth about yourself, you'll be happy. 24/7 happiness can come if you can see the very nature of this creation. If you can see how it's a drama being played out, how the very structure of this creation is a play designed by consciousness. What is consciousness? Consciousness is the ability to be conscious of anything, to be aware of anything. It's a creative process. It's a creative power. Consciousness does not mean something to be conscious of that pre-existing. You can be consciousness of something that is created by consciousness, and then you become aware of it at the same time. Very old question philosophers have been asking. Is a tree there because you are seeing it? Or you are seeing it because tree is there? In other words, does the physical tree make your seeing possible? Or seeing is making a tree possible? Good question. Those who say a tree has to be there before you can see it, we call them materialists. And they are trying to press their point for thousands of years. Those who say, no, unless you see, tree does not exist, they are called idealists. They have been pressing their point for thousands of years. And I believe this debate will go on for another thousands of years. That are we creating our reality and experiencing it? Or is there outside reality? We have merely come to experience it. Which is the truth? In logic, they say, the answer will be, whatever comes first will be the cause. Whatever comes later will be the effect. That used to be the old argument. Therefore, unless you bring a tree in front of you, you can't see it. The tree is a cause. But the bringing of tree in front of you is the same experience like the tree. It's a physical experience. That does not answer the question. You are seeing of the bringing of the tree, and the tree is the same thing. Then can we measure the time difference between the tree and the seeing of the tree? There is no time difference at all. They are simultaneous experiences. The tree and the seeing of the tree are simultaneous with a no time gap at all. Therefore, does not answer the question, which is the cause, which is the effect. But if you go within, you get the answer. And answer surprises us because we find seeing caused the tree and not what we believed all our life, the tree caused us to see it. Now, when you discover that as a truth from inside, you discover that all realities have been created from consciousness. Not only the physical reality, the inner realities I spoke of are all created by consciousness. Therefore, the ultimate reality turns out to be that the self is consciousness. The true self, the soul, is consciousness. And those who have been able to attain it are called perfect living masters. When they share this experience with us, they are called perfect living masters. Why are they called perfect? Because all imperfection that we know of arises from the mind. If you have transcended the mind, everything looks perfect. because everything is in place. The imperfection comes from the mind. If you have transcended the mind, you are perfect. Why are they called living masters? Because they're living like us, ordinary human beings. The only difference between such a person and ourselves is their awareness. They are aware of the whole show, how it's taking place, and we are not. That's the only difference. Supposing they are not living, people try to follow masters who have died. They say, I am getting messages from a master who is dead. All those messages are from the mind. Some people tell me, we have masters, ascended masters in the Himalayas, in India. I have actually worked in the Himalayas for a long time. And I've seen so many masters. They have no idea of anybody calling them for help. All mind. The mind is making up all that. A living human being sitting in front of us, he can tell us, no, this is not true, this is your mind. A dead master, a master living somewhere else, an ascended master, cannot do that. It's only our mind answering our questions. And since the mind is interested in our attachments and desires outside, it doesn't help us to go in at all. It resists. That is why those belief systems which we think that we can believe in dead masters or we can believe in distant masters are just following their mind as their master. They're nobody else at all. If you go higher inside yourself, you discover the fallacy of such belief. So there's so many questions that are answered just by an actual practice of going within your own self. When we discover we are the soul, consciousness per se, a unit of consciousness, is that the ultimate reality of our own self? Many people have believed yes. Discovering an immortal soul, living in your true home, which is immortal, is a final discovery. Not according to my master, whose picture you see here. He said there's one step more, a very important step. He said just like these bodies are covering upon the self, even the sense of individuation, the self, you are one, and there are many, is also an illusion and a covering upon ourself. And that can be removed also. How does the many become one? We read about it. We are all one. We say, we are all one, but I hate that person. I don't like that one. What kind of oneness is that? It's a mental game. The truth is, our source is one totality of consciousness. There's no individuation in reality. Now that final step, how does it happen? It's by the pull of love from totality to the individuated soul. What is totality? They say, let's call it God. God is love. I understand that statement. God is love. But not a lover, not a beloved. God is one. Everything is in God. Everything is part of God. Totality of consciousness is one. And that totality is love. How does it become an experience of love? That one becomes the many and becomes lover and beloved. That love becomes an experience by the many. A justification for creation of the many. And it goes on right up to here. That we are many to be able to experience love amongst each other, between each other. That doesn't happen if it's only oneness. So the creative power of totality of consciousness has generated the many for the purpose of appreciation of beauty, for sharing intuitive knowledge, for sharing love. And that's at the highest stages, that's the old life. There's no thinking there. There are no doubts there. There are no fears there. Have you ever noticed where doubt comes from? And we all have some doubts. Mind. Only mind. Our consciousness has no doubt whatsoever. Soul never has a doubt. Only the mind. Why? because of ignorance of the future. The mind does not know what will happen. And what does doubt lead to? Fear. We are afraid. Can you imagine our doubts and fears are coming from the very great device given to us to express ourselves, to make sense of things? Our mind. Our mind creates doubt, mind creates fear. When we transcend the mind, a clarity comes which can never come otherwise, no doubt. Fear goes away. You become totally fearless. Now imagine a possibility as human being sitting here to become totally fearless at all time. That comes only when you discover you are not the mind. It's just an instrument you are using. You are above it. That awareness changes everything around you. I have come to share these things with you, and I hope you will be able to benefit from some of my experiences if you are interested in these things. Follow the practices. Try to find a suitable guide who can tell you about these things and make you practice. We need a guide only for the sake of actual help in beating our mind that tries to take us out. Some people have asked me if the ultimate truth can be called God Almighty and is inside us, the whole discovery is inside, why do we need an agent outside? We don't need an agent outside if the discovery is inside. The problem is we don't know how to go inside. Okay, if the role of the outsider is merely to tell us how to go inside, that should be enough. That's not enough. We close our eyes, see the darkness, we open and go out again. Then shouldn't something pull us from inside? When we go inside, we discover the person we call a perfect living master was only an image outside. The real master is inside. The real master manifests inside. And that real master is pulling from inside. When we reach the highest place, we discover our own self was the master. Nobody else. Our own self. We can't find the self. We can't. We are living totally outside. When we discover inside, our own self was pulling us inside. But we did not know. It expresses itself in creation. And an outside master appears only for that reason. That real master is always inside. These truths come into our experience through proper meditation and going within. I'm very happy I got a chance to come here to Tallinn, to Estonia, and share these things with you. It was my desire to come and see you for a long time. I'm glad my desire is fulfilled. Thank you very much for very patiently listening to me.